Now we are going to ask our friends to reflect on the lecture that we have heard from Vandana Shiva, and they will ask questions individually. You have microphones, you just have to turn them to you, you don't have to speak into them, but you have to turn them into your direction. And I would like Kristín Vala to be the first to ask a question. Kristín, go ahead.
Thank you, Vandana Shiva, for sharing your wisdom with you. I would like to ask you to elaborate a bit more about soil. Soil is the what makes life on Earth possible, but yet people know very little about it and don't seem to care very much about it. And I'd like you to talk about the freedom of soil and the soil as a source for biodiversity and soil as a source of, for the enrichment of life on the planet.
Soil was just reduced to dirt, as if it was dirty. And the less you needed to soil your hands, the cleaner your agriculture. The problem was everything clean that was introduced was really dirty. Whether it be the fertilizers or the pesticides. The entire Green Revolution, if you look at the textbooks, they talk about the soil as an empty container of dead material to which is added nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium that come from factories. And Sir Albert Howard, who is known as the father of modern organic farming, was sent in 1905 to India by the British to improve Indian agriculture. And he arrived and said there were no pests in the fields, the soils were fertile. He says, I threw away my spray guns and I decided to turn the pest and the peasant into my teacher on how to do good farming. As a result of which he learned about composting and improved it through what he called that indoor method. And he talks about how a war mentality of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium became a habit after the wars had ended. The freedom of the soil, for me, is the freedom of every species that's in the soil. It's the freedom of the earthworm to be able to make burrows so water can infiltrate, or the earthworm, through its mold, can create more fertility than any fertilizer factory ever can. We actually measure the nutrients in the mold of the earthworm through our vermicompost. Interestingly, Darwin wrote a whole book on the earthworm. And he said, when human history will be written, the earthworm will be recognized as the most important species for human survival. And this is the man who wrote about the origin of the species. The mycorrhizae, which were recognized at the time of Howard as being important, I don't know how many of you have seen the film called Avatar. Yeah? Avatar. Right? And you notice how the plants are talking to each other? Well, they do. It's not science fiction. The mycorrhizae can travel meters and meters to pick up a little bit of phosphate, a little bit of potassium, and bring it to the plant that needs it by creating these collaborative relationships. The living soil is all the beneficial bacteria that decompose biomass and turn it into fertility in humus. And we've done surveys on BT cotton. 22% of the beneficial bacteria have been killed in the first few years of farming. So the freedom of the soil also, in my view, is in our times, includes the freedom of the soil to be. Because soil is being covered by concrete everywhere. And I think cementification is a war against the soil. But soil is also being grabbed through land grab. And we witness that in India, we witness it in Africa. As more soil is destroyed, in countries which have economic power, they think they can use their economic power to go invade other countries and take over their soil. We call it a land war. So the freedom of the soil is basically the soil being free, but giving you freedom to be able to meet your needs by taking care of the soil, by living with the soil, and therefore within the limits of our ecosystem. I started to travel a lot after I realized what the World Bank was doing. And before that I thought, oh, I'll do local protection of my valley and our forests. And I've always carried a bit of soil with me. It's after 9/11 it became illegal. You can't carry soil.
We have a very special soil here in Iceland, Landanna. It has a free will. And it blows quite easily because of the strong wind out to the seas. But we also have people who are trying to conserve our soil in the middle of the highlands and preserve it for the winds. But Stefán Gíslason, you have a question for Landanna Sívá.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank you very much for your most inspiring presentation. As you mentioned, we have been experiencing a tough economic crisis, and we are trying to pave our way out of it. And when like politicians are discussing how we are doing on the way out of the crisis, they're always saying the same things like, most likely we'll have economic growth again this year, next year, something like that, 2% next year. And what I'm wondering, okay, maybe we can get out of the crisis by increasing economic growth, or by increasing GDP. But what I'm getting at is basically, okay, let's say that we do this in a, or within the framework of green economy. Let's assume that we are able to, you know, create economic growth through green economy. But what I'm getting at is basically whether economic growth can be sustained or whether it can go on forever, as long as it is green, or whether we have to, you know, create a completely different society with zero growth or deep growth. So the main question is this, okay, can we go on forever with economic growth as long as it is green?
Well, you know, the fact that you can't go on forever is already showing in all the countries that had growth and don't have growth anymore. So anyone should learn that limitless growth and growth forever is a very, very false assumption. And interestingly, you know, every period, a different set of countries is put up as an example of how successful growth can be. In the 1990s, it used to be the Asian tigers, 1997. And then that collapsed. Then they had to find new poster children. And India and China became the new poster children. But what do you measure when you measure growth? If a river is flowing free, there's no growth, even though life is growing, even though ecological production is taking place. But when you dam the river, you get growth, because now you're extracting energy out of it. If you have a forest that's living, you have growth in the forest. That's what my sisters in Chipko were defending. Everything that the forest provided, there's growth. But it isn't economic growth. It's only when you cut the tree that suddenly a dead tree becomes growth. So something is extremely wrong with the way we measure growth. And I mentioned this in the earlier morning session. I think the person who's done the best analysis of this is a former parliamentarian of New Zealand, Marilyn Waring. And she says, when I start to figure out how do you calculate growth, it was really created to mobilize resources for the war. And in order to do that, they had to say there's no production in the household. There's no production if you're working for society. But if you put the money out and buy weapons, suddenly growth takes place. So the very concept of GDP was created to mobilize resources for wars, and it defined growth in terms of gross domestic product. Was defined, if you produce what you consume, then you don't produce, and it doesn't get measured in the gross domestic product. So all the household work doesn't get measured. All of nature's economy and the tremendous work she does, they're now figuring out that pollinators alone contribute 50 billion to the food system. But all of that didn't count for growth. I think not only was it wrong when it was started, but in this period of economic crisis, it has become a very dangerous measure because it can pull entire economies down when the growth bursts, because it's resting on very artificial assumptions, as I mentioned, about fictitious finance. So that, of course, there's another way, and the other way is really two things. A little country called Bhutan has said we won't measure gross domestic product because it's an illusion. We won't measure gross national product. We will measure gross national happiness. Rests on four pillars: the health of nature and the environment, the resilience of their culture, the respect for values, and sustainability in any economic activity. And if it passes those four screens, you know, they went through this amazing exercise and said, okay, if we were to join the WTO, what would it do to our society? Would it increase the happiness, or would it lead to a decline? They worked out and said, no, it would lead to a loss of happiness, so they haven't signed up to the World Trade Organization. And again, you know, because Iceland is such a strong nature-based society, I think it could easily evolve gross national happiness as its objective. And I think it would be a very good response to IMF and all the banks. So you care. You don't care for your profits, you care for our profits.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you, you have added this to the list of the IMF. But our next question is coming from Dominique. Dominique, that's well.
Yes, first of all, of course, I'd like to thank you so very much. It's been a privilege to be able to listen to you. And I would suggest to anyone who is able to take the message to get you twice and twice a year to say and repeat these messages so we really take them and live them. But my question would be about around food security and food sovereignty. You showed us, and well, I think many of us knew it, that food security today, what we're calling it, is mainly a question of not getting the food communities to provide enough for the greed of the banking system and the economic systems. And the right, the primarily human right of people of being fed is more or less ignored in the situation. In a country which is like Iceland, which is a rich country, we do have as well a responsibility concerning calling food, food, not only looking at the price label on the food and considering it as a commodity. How do you see in such a society and such surroundings the way to do it? For example, when the city of Reykjavik needs to spare the start, to spare by closing the school gardens where the kids were able to grow their own vegetables. So how do you go into thinking food and food supply and food security in an industrial country.
Well, I think one of the key challenges, food sovereignty in richer countries, which have always assumed that food can be bought on a supermarket shelf, is the very uneven support given to industrialized, globalized agriculture. And that's why the Common Agriculture Policy, which is supposed to be reviewed in 2013, should be a major subject to put in all the initiatives that could provide food security and food sovereignty, but also add to cultural enrichment. You know, I think every school should have a garden because it cultivates values. You're not just cultivating a garden, you're cultivating a human being. And no government should be left with the excuse that we don't have the resources. You know, there are large amount of resources today being spent on subsidies for biofuels, subsidies for industrial agriculture, subsidies for chemicals, subsidies to create non-sustainable systems. And they need to be redirected to create sustainable systems. I often say that biodiversity is not just important for us in the south. To bring back biodiversity in agriculture is vital also for the north. Because no system can be truly sustainable without biodiversity. And Dominique, you took me for this wonderful lunch at the Nordic House yesterday, where they had put biodiversity on the plate. All research has shown that the more diversified a diet, the healthier the people. And the Italians have managed to put their cuisine on the UNESCO heritage list. I think we just need to be much, much more caring about our biodiversity and see biodiversity as food through which we can diversify our agriculture and, while lowering the cost of production, increase the well-being of our people. But that still means that the public support for the right kind of farming has to be available. And because you're part of Europe, obviously it has to be a national redirection as well as a regional redirection.
These ideas about subsidies for organic farmers, we have been fighting in the Parliament of Iceland for years to get this through. Now is the possibility of doing it. Svandís? Yes. And now is the turn of Andrés Snær Magnússon.
Thank you, Amanda, for the greatly inspiring lecture. I can tell you that national growth happiness went up to 7.5% when we heard you were coming to Iceland. And I hope you come every year to sustain at least this percent. I had 100 questions, and I'm still kind of trying to choose. I didn't know you were going to talk about the bauxite and aluminum industry, but and I followed this battle that you were talking about in the Neongiri hills that were going to be destructed. But because aluminum or bauxite is non-renewable, it's a finite source. That means the production machine is gnawing itself and will eventually knock on these doors again, like in the Neongiri hills. We are addicted in Iceland to the extraction of about 2 million tons a year of this this vital material. Do you think this gives us greater responsibility because now we are a part of this chain? How can we be more aware of what is happening, and will you let us know when the knock on the door in Neongiri Hills next time. Or maybe tell us the situation there, because there the locals seem to be fighting it, while in Iceland the locals seem to be very keen on these big factories.
Well, I think one idea could be to bring the locals who won't have any smelters here to come visit Niamiri. But of course, you know, they are already knocking on the door. They're trying to file a case to overturn the ruling that stopped the mining. But I will definitely keep you informed, and we need to definitely move beyond this very predatory production system.
I'm going to give you the opportunity of another question. I know you have 100 on the list, I saw you writing them, so I'm giving you another opportunity.
Well, the other question was, we are not 70% water, we are 90% oil. If you look at the graph of oil production in the last century and the population of mankind, it seems like it goes together. It seems like the oil creates us, it drags the fish ashore, it creates this huge biomass that we are managed to fish and log and harvest. Can you see that we can sustain 6 billion human beings with this? We're at the end of oil, we're at peak oil. Some people think that, okay, that means population will go back down again. Do you see that we can sustain this population of mankind and even more people with these organic methods that you have been promoting?
I think it's the only way to sustain humanity without destroying the planet. If you have limitation of land, it makes sense to grow more on less land. And it's falsely said that industrial agriculture intensifies land use. No, it extensifies land use, otherwise why would they be invading the Amazon forest? If it was doing so well, why would they be grabbing land in Africa? It's chemical intensive, it's not land intensive. Biodiverse systems grow more food per unit acre. And my favorite is something that grows across the world. Native Americans do it, we do it. Corn, beans, pumpkins. The Native Americans call it the Three Sisters. Now, on an acre of land, if you're growing corn and bean and pumpkin, overall you're getting more food and more biomass. If you're only growing a monoculture of corn, no matter how productive it be and how much fossil fuel you've pumped into it, it's less than the Three Sisters. And if you grow only beans, again, it's less than the Three Sisters. So we need to intensify biologically and we need to intensify ecologically. We need to intensify the ecological processes going on in the soil. In effect, chemical agriculture kills those processes. Industrial agriculture uses more water. If you're running out of water, you don't have an agriculture that uses more water. In a time of peak oil, as you mentioned, you don't depend on an agriculture that's so dependent on oil that we could say we are eating oil, because so much of what's going into the food, as you mentioned, is dependent on oil. Peak oil means you better phase out. And again, Iceland is so well placed with energy systems. And it would be sad to fritter it away on aluminium.
Gunnar Falk Olafsson, you're the last one in the line of visitors here to the stage. Yes, right.
Shiva, it's a pleasure to be here with you. Thank you for coming to Iceland. I have a basic question about a basic element of Earth, water. And I want to mention here that Vandana Shiva has written a fantastic book, Water Wars, Privatization, Pollution, and Profit. Iceland has tremendous water wealth for a small country. Having such great resources, it is of no surprise that investors and corporations are all over the world are knocking on our doors trying to buy water rights and land. Pardon that I have to elaborate on this question of mine, because many Icelanders do not know that in 2006 the government and parliament of Iceland intended to steal the water commons and privatize them. Actually, it happened. But the law was so bad that it was never implemented. It shows our political respect and understanding for water, nature, and life that water laws and the water resource is at the responsibility of the Minister of Industry. Industry. Not the Minister of Environment. As we say in Iceland, there are many strange things in the cow's head. Now, since 2006, a water committee worked on a new and progressive water bill. It ensured common rights of everyone, water conservation, ecological protection, and sustainable water use. Its fault was to permit the lease and sale of water rights. Now, we're back at point zero. Recently, the Minister of Industry threw out his good work, and three lawyers drew hastily up a new bill. And we have the ghost of the bad 2006 law before the Parliament. There is need to worry. In this light, finally, I come to the question. In this light, what advice can you, the world expert on water politics, give us, the Parliament, the government of Iceland, the people of Iceland, on the making and implementing water legislation that is progressive, democratic, and sustainable?
I never like to put myself in the position of giving advice. I like to share experience, and the experience I would share is our experiences in India, two experiences. One was where a small group of women stopped Coca-Cola from mining the groundwater, 1.5 million liters a day is what they were doing. And the outcome of this was the courts recognizing that water is a commons. And Delhi's water supply was being privatized, as usual, under World Bank IMF pressure. And we built a movement for water democracy. The water was coming from Delhi and would be sold in Delhi at 10 times the price of what the water, current water taxes are. And we built a movement saying our Mother Ganga is not for sale. And when Paul, he was the head of World Bank for a short while, till he ended up giving too many privileges to his girlfriend. No, that was the IMF guy. They're all the same. You know, he came to privatize India's water. 40 billion loans is what he was promising. And I didn't seek an appointment with me, but, you know, the World Bank said, would you like to come and talk? And of course I went. And I carried a little bit of Ganges water. And said, this is to let you know that for the majority of people in the world, water is not a commodity. It is not just a common good. It's actually sacred common good. And I think all laws, any law made on water today, should recognize that water is a commons, should recognize that water democracy is vital to the governance of water, and should recognize that water has rights as part of nature's rights. And therefore, rivers have rights. And it's not about, I found the writings about why aluminium was brought in. Oh, we have so much energy and so much water, we're not using it all. But who said it was to be used up for? Now, for this country, Iceland could definitely lead the way in another way of thinking about water. Two amazing things have happened in this past year. One is the United Nations passed a resolution on water as a human right. They didn't go far enough to talk about water's rights. But Italy had a law on privatization with Mr. Berlusconi, who loves to privatize everything. And the people were very troubled, and they called for a referendum. And then it became a referendum on water privatization, on nuclear, and on immunity of President Berlusconi. 92% of people who came out to vote voted for water as a common and public good. And I think that is definitely the way forward. Iceland can do it very easily, and the way to do it would be to have more discussions. Anyway, Icelandic people love their snow and water, but to turn it into the issue of can it be privately owned, can it be turned into a tradable commodity, to add that issue would, in my view, shape the next step of democracy on this beautiful island.